2 Samuel chapter 6, starting in verse 6. And here we go. We're going to read the scriptures. And when they came to Nacon's threshing floor, Uzzah put forth his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it, for the oxen shook it. Now, I have to tell you that one of my prayers this morning was going to be that the Lord would help stop me to begin to explain when I needed to explain some things, because once again, we have people at various levels of understanding this morning. So if you have a lot of understanding about certain things, then I just need you to bear with me, okay? But I'm going to do what I felt like the Lord wanted me to do, and I'm going to stop and explain. First off, the name Uzzah means strength. Secondly, what's actually going on here is that David, the king, the promised king that God promised to Israel, who is a type of Jesus in the Old Testament, we'll talk a little bit more about that in a second, is bringing the Ark of the Covenant back to Jerusalem. Previously in Israel's history before this, they had lost the Ark of the Covenant because of various rebellion and failure that was taking place in the land. And for quite some time, the Ark of the Covenant was not in the house, in Jerusalem or in Israel's presence. Sorry, I see people waving the fans. All right. So the Ark of the Covenant is coming back into God's people's possession, and the Ark of the Covenant represents the presence of God. The reason why the Ark of the Covenant represents the presence of God is because in the wilderness there was a structure known as a tabernacle, which was basically a tent that was portable and able to be moved around, and also later in the temple, which was a structure that wasn't portable, but that it was stationary, there was a place behind a veil called the Holy of Holies where the Ark of the Covenant was. If you saw Raiders of the Lost Ark, that was the Ark of the Covenant, right? That box that had the angels on top of it, and the Ten Commandments were in it. But what the situation was that once a year, this is the place where God's presence was said to dwell with his people, was behind the veil, on the mercy seat, between the cherubim, which was known as the Ark of the Covenant. God's presence was in that place. And once a year, the high priest would enter in through the veil, and he would apply blood to the mercy seat. And it was the shedding of blood, which was a type of the cross of Jesus, that allowed communion or relationship to be restored between sinful man and a holy God. Amen? And so we see this picture being painted in the Old Testament long before Jesus ever shows up on the scene. So now the presence of God, the Ark of the Covenant, has been lost. Let me tell you something. As a Christian, you can find yourself in the midst of places in your own walk, in your own life, where you have become rebellious, where you've become disobedient, where you no longer feel the presence of God anymore in your life. But in this situation, and also in your situation, if you reach out to the Lord, if you call upon his name, if you apply the blood, amen, to your life, just as they applied the blood to the mercy seat, the presence of God is now able to come home. That's what's happening. The presence of God is coming home to the place where it belongs. They're bringing back the Ark of the Covenant. But Uzzah, which means strength, he did something he wasn't supposed to do. He tried to stabilize the presence of God. When it shook, they were carrying it all wrong. I don't have time to get into all the details. They weren't supposed to put it on a cart. They weren't supposed to drag it with an ox. It was supposed to be carried a specific way, and they weren't doing it the right way. But because of this, the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God smote him there for his error. And there he died by the Ark of God. And David was displeased because the Lord had made a breach upon Uzzah. And he called the name of the place Perez Uzzah to this day. So Uzzah means strength, and Perez means breach. And I had to look up the idea of the word breach, and it really means to come from behind and to break in. It's almost like David felt like God ambushed him. He wasn't ready. I mean, you hoodwinked me, Lord. What happened here? I'm displeased. I don't understand. Well, you didn't go back to the Word of God. You didn't go back to what God requires. And so the thing of it is that Uzzah wasn't strong enough. Amen. Man tries to do things in his own strength, and the reality of it is God showed up and showed him who was really strong here. So David was afraid of the Lord that day and said, "How shall the ark of the Lord come to me?" So David would not remove the ark of the Lord unto him into the city of David. But David carried it aside into the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite. And the ark of the Lord continued in the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite, 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. And it was told King David, saying, "The Lord hath blessed the house of Obed-Edom, and all that pertaineth unto him, because of the ark of God." So David went and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom into the city of David with gladness. And it was so that when they that bare the ark of the Lord had gone 6 paces, he sacrificed oxen and fatlings. Now, we've talked about this many times in this church since we've started, but I do believe that it's important for people to understand that many times whenever this passage was preached in the past, they talked about the fact that the reason the presence of God was coming home, we haven't gotten there yet, was because David was dancing full of joy. I've heard many a preacher preach that's how you bring the presence of God into your life. You're going to worship. You're going to praise God, and you're going to, don't get me wrong, you can experience the presence of God when you humble yourself and you worship Him and you praise Him. You can do that in your own home. I've experienced great times with the Lord just through the humility of saying, "God, I need you. God, I want to have a relationship with you," right? But that's not consistent with how you can have a relationship with God. The way that you and I have a relationship with the presence of God is what it says right there in verse 13. When they bear the ark of the Lord and they've gone 6 paces, that means 6 steps. The number 6 is the number of man. Man was created on the 6th day. Every 6 paces, an oxen or a fatling had to be sacrificed. The blood was shed. Sacrifice was made. This is alone was allowing the presence of God to come back into the house of God. The presence of God, your relationship with that is ever contingent upon, ever dependent upon your faith in what Christ has done for you at the cross. That alone is what allows you to have communion with God, to have relationship with God. It says right here, though, that as they were doing this, David danced before the Lord with all his might, and David was girded with a linen ephod. What that means is that he didn't have on his royal apparel. He wasn't dressed like a king. He had undressed himself. He had made himself common amongst the people. He had humbled himself and lowered himself because he was in the presence of God, and he was excited that the presence of God was coming back. David wasn't a man that was worried about the appearance of things. David was a man that loved God with all of his heart. David was a man that had seen God move in his life. David was a man that had killed giants because of the power of God, had killed lions with his own hands, had killed bears with his own hands. He knew that when he was a young boy, he did these things. Teenager, he knew that he couldn't have accomplished these things in his own strength. He knew that God had a plan for his life, and if nobody else was going to be excited about the presence of God, if nobody else was going to worship the Lord, David was going to do it, and he knew that he couldn't do it in pomp and circumstance. In other words, he could not try to elevate himself. He couldn't try to make himself look good. Listen, whenever the prophet Nathan went to go anoint David to be the king, God warned Nathan, when you go to anoint him, don't look at his outward appearance. Don't look at his stature. Don't look at how tall he is or how handsome he is, because you're going to get tricked if you do that. Man looks at the outward. Yeah. I look at the heart.
Amen.
God is inspecting the heart of his people. Amen. He's not looking at the outward appearance. There's a whole lot of religion. There's a whole lot of things that look good outwardly, but the inside is not good. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
God's wanting to do a work on the inside of his people. Yeah. All right? But the problem with us is this, is that we still see outwardly. We see how things look. We become fearful that if people see us a certain way, they're going to think a certain way about us. Don't say that it's not true, because even the most cocky and arrogant of people are concerned about the way they're viewed by people on the outside. And they change things, they manipulate circumstances in order to allow themselves to look the way that they want to look many times. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of the trumpet. And as the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michael, some people say Michal, but I looked it up and it's Michael. I don't know why they would say a girl's name like that, but they do. Michael, Saul's daughter, looked through a window and saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. And they brought in the ark of the Lord and set it in his place, and in the midst of the tabernacle that David had pitched for it. And David offered burnt offerings and peace offerings before the Lord. And as soon as David had made an end of offering burnt offerings and peace offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord of hosts. And he dealt among the people, even among the whole multitude of Israel, as well as to the women as men, to everyone a cake of bread and a good piece of flesh and a flagon of wine. So all the people departed, everyone to his house. Now, I'm not trying to make more out of this than what it is, but New Testament-wise, bread and wine represent communion with God. And one of the things that this text is really trying to point out to us with certainty is that David did this for everybody, not just for the men. Because you see, in that society, it was a patriarchal society. Men were given more credence than women were. But in this particular situation, the scripture is clear to us that the king offered this to everybody, not just the men, but also the women. And in my eyes, this is a type of communion. King David, who represents a type of Christ, the presence of God, I believe in this little portion of the story, this is just one little part, that God is revealing to us that communion is for all. For all to be able to have a relationship and to be able to experience the presence of God. So all the people departed, everyone to his house. Then David returned to bless his household. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet David and said, "How glorious." Now she's being facetious. She's being obnoxious. Have you ever met anybody like that before? That's what she's doing. "How glorious was the king of Israel today, who uncovered himself today in the eyes of the handmaids of his servants as one of the vain fellows shamelessly uncovers himself." And David said unto Michal, "It was before the Lord which chose me before your father." See, Michal was Saul's daughter, who was the original king. And we're going to get into that in a second on the connection between David and Michal, this first wife of his. I want you to see that part and how he actually attained her and the way that he purchased her. It's a little bit graphic, but it makes one of the points that I'm trying to talk about. He says, David said unto Michal, "It was before the Lord which chose me before your father and before all his house to appoint me ruler over the people of the Lord, over Israel. Therefore will I play before the Lord." The word play means to be full of joy, to be full of hope, to be full of happiness. "And I will yet be more vile than thus." You think this looked bad? This embarrassed you a little bit? This appearance of the king and the way that he acted, you think that this made you feel a little bit funny? Wait, it's going to get even better. He said, "I will be base in my own sight." Base means I will humble myself. I'm going to lower myself even more if that's what the Lord asks me to do. And he goes on to say, "And of the maidservants which thou hast spoken of them shall I be had in honor." In other words, you were worried about the way that I looked to those maidservants. And the scripture already said that she despised him in her heart. He said, "You might think lowly of me, but the rest of the people, the rest of the congregation, that's not how they're going to see it. I'm going to look like a good king in their eyes because they're going to get it. They're going to understand what it is that I'm doing." Not everybody's going to understand whenever you lower yourself to serve the Lord. Not everybody's going to understand when you humble yourself to truly live for Him. Much of to this morning's message, we haven't gotten into it yet, really, is really the descriptive between religion and relationship, between law and grace, between your first life and your new life. And what I'm here to tell you is people aren't going to always understand that. And Michal represents the first life. She is the first wife. She's the first marriage, if you will. And it goes on to say right here, "Therefore Michal, the daughter of Saul, had no child unto the day of her death." She was barren. She had no fruit that came out of her. All right. Now we're going to go to 1 Samuel chapter 25. We'll start off in verse 3. So in the first story, we read of Michal. My original title was Marriage to a King, or Married to a King, and then I changed it to Communion with a King. But I want you to know that much of the idea, I mean, it's about communion, which means common union and relationship. But it also talks about the concept of marriage, being connected to. And so it says right here, now the name of, starting in verse 3, and so the first, Michal was his first wife, and now Abigail, is his second. Now the name of the man was Nabal, and the name of his wife, Abigail, and she was a woman of good understanding. Now, the name Nabal literally means fool. And she was a woman of good understanding and of a beautiful countenance, but the man was churlish and evil in his doings. I'm going to explain that word churlish in a little bit. He was of the house of Caleb, and David heard in the wilderness that Nabal did shear his sheep. And David sent out 10 young men, and David said unto the young men, get you up to Carmel and go to Nabal and greet him in my name. Now, understand that we're going backwards in the story. And if you understand the life of David, and maybe you don't, so let me explain a little bit. I've told this part of the story many times when he was in the field and it was time for him to be anointed by Nathan the prophet, like I explained earlier. He was a young teen. He was like probably a teenage boy. And they called him out of the field. They anointed him to be king, and everybody knew that he was supposed to be king. There was a period in David's life when he was really on the run. Saul was still king. David was supposed to be king, and Saul was persecuting him. And so David, to some extent, was on the run. This is during part of that time frame. While he was gone, Saul took his wife, Michal, whom David had won through battle, and gave her to another man to be his wife. Whenever David became king, that's one of the first things he did, and I'll show you the scripture where he said it. He said, hey, go back and fetch my wife. Okay, but so during this time frame, David was married to her, but now he's gone, and she's been given to another man, and now David comes upon this particular situation with Abigail, and you're going to see through the course of this part of the story that Abigail becomes his wife also. And there's spiritual meaning that I'm trying to pull out of all of that whenever it's all said and done. It says, and thus shall you say to him, get you up, go to Carmel, go to Nabal, and greet him in my name, verse 6. Thus shall you say to him that lives in prosperity, peace be both to thee, and peace be to thine house, and peace be unto all that thou hast. And now I have heard that thou hast shearers, people that shear sheep. And now your shepherds, which were with us, we hurt them not. Neither was there aught missing unto them all the while they were in Carmel. In other words, David's saying to his men, listen, we've been with Nabal, we've been there, we've helped him, we've helped protect him. I want you to go remind him what it is that we've done for him. Ask your young men and they will show you. Wherefore, let the young men find favor in your eyes, for we come in a good day. In other words, we come in peace. Give, I pray thee, whatsoever comes to thine hand unto thy servants and to thy son David. And when David's young men came, they spoke to Nabal according to all those words in the name of David and ceased. So in other words, listen, this is the new king. This is the one that God has appointed. We're representing him. We've been with you. We've been working with you by your side. We've protected you because David had, while he was on the run, God kept sending him more and more men and became more and more powerful as the time went on. But what this represents, though, also is the difference between the old order, the old covenant, or the first birth, and the new order, the new covenant, and the new birth in Christ Jesus. David as a type of the new king, the righteous king, versus really Saul, which was a type of the old life, the old sin, or the flesh. And now it's time for the new king to be embraced. And this Nabal is representative of the first marriage, of first concept of marriage, or the first life before conversion to Christ. All right? And so it says, and Nabal answered David's servants and said, who is David? Well, you know who David is. This isn't a secret. The word spread fast that David was anointed to be king. But what he's saying is he's holding his allegiance to the original king, to Saul. He says, and who is David and who is the son of Jesse? Well, Jesse was David's daddy. And everybody knew who Jesse was and who David was. There be many servants nowadays that break away every man from his master. In other words, he's trying to say that David's illegitimate. David just broke away from Saul. And many times, let me just say this right here, many times people have a difficult time breaking away from their old life, the master of their old life. Whether it was your first birth in Adam and your relationship with sin and the ways of the world, even, I'm just going to be honest with you, when I was talking about music, it aggravated some. It's possible that it aggravated some people that have brought that up. It's difficult sometimes for us to break away from everything that we knew before. It's difficult sometimes for us to break away from the world that we were connected to. But the reality of it is that many times people don't want to break away. And that's what Nabal represents. He doesn't want to break away from Saul. He doesn't want to embrace the new. He doesn't want to embrace King David, which is a type of Jesus and a new life with him. But it can also represent religion. Many times people, when they've grown up in a church in a particular situation with tradition and rules and regulations, there's a big difference between religion and relationship. Religion is just as bad as smoking crack. I'm here to tell you right now, religion will destroy you. It will kill you. It is not going to bring forth freedom and liberty. And not only will it kill you, but it will kill everybody around you, because you will begin to judge everybody based upon what your opinion is on what a right relationship with God is. And the only right relationship with God is not your opinion, and it's not my opinion, but it is the opinion of the Word of God. That's right. And that's what Nabal is. He wants to hold on to that old way of life. He wants to hold on to that old master. He doesn't want to let go. He wants to cling to it tightly. And so it says right here in verse 11, "Shall I then take my bread and my water and my flesh that I have killed for my shearers and give it unto men whom I know not whence they be?" I don't know who you are. "So David's young men turned their way and went again and came and told him all those sayings. David said unto his men, gird ye on every man his sword." Put on your swords. And they girded on every man his sword, and David also girded on his sword. And there went up after David about 400 men, and 200 abode by the stuff. But one of the young men told Abigail, Nabal's wife, saying, "Behold, David sent messengers out of the wilderness to salute our master, and he railed on them." It means he screamed at them, and he gave them a hard time. He spoke verbally negatively to them. "But the men were very good unto us, and we were not hurt. Neither missed we anything, as long as we were conversant with them when we were in the fields. They were a wall unto us, both by night and day, all the while we were with them keeping the sheep." In other words, David's men have been with us. They were in the field. They were protecting us. That we had relationship with them. We talked to them. They've been good to us. And now this is what your husband is going to do. "Now therefore know and consider what you will do. For evil is determined against our master and against all his household. For he is such a son of Belial." That's another way of saying the son of the devil in the Old Testament. "That a man cannot speak to him." I mean, can you get a picture of this guy? I mean, he's just obstinate. That's really what the word churlish means, by the way. Obstinate, stubborn, unwilling to bend, refusal to see the right thing. Have you ever known anybody like that? Have you ever lived with anybody like that? Have you ever had a relationship with anybody like that? That's old school, hard school of hard knocks, stubborn. Wants to oppress you and hold you under their hand and squash you down. That's the kind of man that Nabal was. If you've ever been around that, it's not a fun thing to be around. A controlling spirit like that. There's no freedom in that. There's no liberty in that. That's what Abigail's been living under. Oppression. Bondage. "Now therefore know and consider," verse 17, "what thou wilt do. For evil is determined against our master and against his household. For he is such a son of Belial that a man cannot speak to him." Then Abigail made haste and took 200 loaves and 200 bottles of wine. There's communion again. She's offering. She's wanting to go out to meet the king. She's wanting to have a right relationship with the new king. She can't speak for her foolish husband Nabal, but she's about to separate herself from that situation. She's about to present herself to the king. "And 5 sheep, ready dressed, and 5 measures of parched corn, and 100 clusters of raisins, and 200 cakes of figs, and laid them on asses," which is another name for donkeys. "And she said unto her servants, go on before me. Behold, I come after you. But she told not her husband Nabal, and it was so, as she rode on the ass, that she came down by the covert of the hill, and behold, David and his men came down against her, and she met them. Now David had said, surely in vain have I kept all that this fellow hath in the wilderness, so that nothing was missed of all that pertained unto him, and he has requited of me evil for good." So here I've been, I sent my men, we've protected his stuff, we've taken care of him, and then now he turns on us and he treats us improperly. He's really saying, I'm the king. I have a right to ask of what it is that I'm asking, but the reality of it is that he's returning evil for the good that I've offered him. He's rejecting the king. He's rejecting this new relationship. And this can also represent people who hear the gospel and refuse. God has done all this good stuff for humanity. Sometimes people just refuse to believe it. But I'm here to tell you, you wouldn't be sitting in here this morning if you didn't at least believe a little bit that it could be true. That God would be good enough That even though you and I, born of Adam, were born sinners and against him, and each and every one of us have gone our own way and done our own thing, even then, still, God in his love would send his only begotten Son, the one who never failed, the one who never sinned, the one who was always obedient, and offer him as a sacrifice for the sole purpose that your sins could be forgiven so that he can have relationship with you. Yet at the same time, you will find if you stay in your relationship with Christ and you are willing to speak of him, you will find that there will be times, conversations, when people will come against you, when people will say that they refuse to believe that. And they're not rejecting you. You need to understand that. I mean, they might reject you if the way you do it. But you know what? Sometimes if you're telling the truth, you're telling the truth. And we all need to be honed. You know, it takes time to knock the rough edges off of a knife to make it sharp. None of us are. And if we don't ever practice talking about Jesus, we'll never learn from the mistakes that we made. Don't let the enemy hold you down in fear because you don't always get it exactly right. The Holy Spirit will lead and guide you. That's right. But the truth is that there's people that return evil to the Lord for all of the good that he's done. They reject him. And that's what Nabal has done. He's rejected the king. Verse 22, so and more also do God unto the enemies of David, if I leave all that pertain to him by the morning light, any that pisseth against the wall. That's kind of weird terminology, right? Pisseth against the wall. King James, that's talking about men, basically. That's what men do. They pee, urinate against the wall. Women don't urinate against the wall. I'm not going to get into all the details. I mean, I suppose a woman, I'm not trying to be weird, but I suppose a woman can lean against the wall when she urinates, okay, but it ain't going to hit the wall. Yes, sir.
In Europe, they still have
bathrooms. Oh, so that was like a deal. They have a wall where the men would urinate against. So, anyway, it's representative of men is the point. The point is he's about to go in. He's about to demolish the men, which represent the strength of Nabal's people. There ain't going to be one left. Not one man's going to be left standing by the time David's done. Because he's resisting. See, and that's what happens. That's what happens when we reject the good counsel of God. God comes to us with an offer. The offer is, like he told the children of Israel in the book of Isaiah. He says, come, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they can be made white as snow. God has a plan and an offer that he's offering mankind. We're all in the same boat. We all have the same sin. But God wants to reason with us. And he wants to let us know. David has read, but when the reasoning is rejected, then there's judgment that's going to come. And so he says, when Abigail saw David, she hasted and lighted off the ass. In other words, she quickly got off the donkey. She fell before David on her face and she bowed herself to the ground. She fell at his feet and said, upon me, my Lord, upon me, let this iniquity be. And let thy handmaid, I pray thee, speak in thine audience and hear the words of thy handmaid. Let not my Lord, I pray thee, in other words, that's a way to say, I beg you, regard this man of Belial, even Nabal, for his name is so is he. He's a fool. Nabal is his name, and folly is with him. But I, thine handmaid, saw not the young men of my Lord whom you did send. Now therefore, my Lord, as the Lord lives, and as thy soul lives, seeing the Lord has withholden thee from coming to shed blood and from avenging thyself with thine own hand, now let thine enemies and they that seek evil to my Lord be as Nabal. And now this blessing which thine handmaid has brought unto my Lord, let it even be given unto the young men that follow my Lord. I pray thee, forgive the trespass of thy handmaid, for the Lord will certainly make my Lord a sure house, because my Lord fights the battles of the Lord, and evil has not been found in thee all thy days. You know, I wasn't planning on using this as one of the proof texts, because I hadn't even really gotten into the message yet, about David being a type of Jesus, but I'll be honest with you, it's just a perfect text right there, verse 28. I pray thee, forgive the trespass of thy handmaid, forgive the sin of me. She's taking responsibility. That is one thing I was going to talk about. She's taking responsibility for her. She's coming to the realization that she herself has failed the king. And she says, for the Lord will certainly make my Lord a sure house. Your house, your kingdom is going to come to pass just as it said that it would. In this world, in this life, this is 1,000 BC we're talking about. 1,000 years before Jesus ever showed up. But the illustration is true. Even though you and I view this world and it looks so much chaos and confusion, it causes people to question, how could God be real? How can God be real? Who? Jesus is coming back? Really? What kind of power does God even have? He can't even stop Muslims from killing this one or people from treating others this way. And they think this, but the reality of it is that mankind has gone against God. Right. Sin is rampant in the world. And God's judgment, it hadn't even really started yet, but God's judgment has started and it's moving towards the end. But you can rest assured, Jesus said, upon this rock I will build my kingdom, amen, and build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. In other words, the rock that he was talking about when he told Peter that is the truth that you spoke of, that I am the Christ, the anointed one, the son of the living God. And I'm going to build my church upon this. And it will prevail. And when it's all said and done, my church will be with me. And Abigail, as a type of the sinner that's looking for grace, says, surely your house will prevail. Surely God will do what he said that he's going to do in you and through you. Because my Lord fights the battles of the Lord. Jesus was sent to this earth to fight the battle of sin for you and I. Jesus was sent, look what it says right here, and evil has not been found in thee all thy days. Jesus was the sinless one sent to the earth to fight the battle of sin, to take sin upon himself. David is a type of Christ. She knows that the kingdom of David is going to rise up and that God's will, God's promise to David is going to come to pass. She wants to be part of that kingdom. She doesn't want to stay in the past. She doesn't want to hold on to the old way. She doesn't want to be like Nabal and cling to the old order and the old way that things are doing, the old master that dominated and oppressed. Instead, she wants to release herself from that. Yet a man has risen to pursue thee, verse 29, and to seek thy soul, but the soul of my Lord shall be bound in the bundle of life with the Lord thy God, and the souls of thine enemies, them shall he sling out as out of the middle of a sling. And it shall come to pass when the Lord shall have done to my Lord according to all. Yeah, I mean, I don't mean to, we don't probably have time to do this, but did you just catch that? Because I didn't catch it the first time or a couple of times I read it. It says right here, and God, the souls of thine enemies, them shall he sling out as out of the middle of a sling. She's referring. Everybody knows about David. Everybody remembers how that giant fell. Just as simple and easy as the day you walk down into the valley of Elah and you put that smooth stone in the midst of that sling and you let that thing fly out and pop, hit that Goliath in the head and he fell down and you cut his head off. Just as simple as I believe what happened, David took that head and rode into around the city of Jerusalem and showed them the victory they got to get. Just as simple as the day that rock came out of that sling, God is going to give you the victory that he promised you and your kingdom is going to come to pass. That's what I believe she's saying right there. I think it's pretty simple. Everybody knew. You don't think everybody knew? You got to go back and you got to read the story. The women would line up and they would sing about David. Thousands of women. Saul killed 1,000, but David killed tens of thousands. And they saw him as a king, and they saw the victory that God had upon his life. And that's the point that she's making. Your kingdom is going to come to pass. That this shall be, verse 30. It shall come to pass when the Lord shall have done to my Lord according to all the good that he has spoken concerning thee, and shall have appointed thee ruler over Israel, that this shall be no grief unto thee, nor offense of heart unto my Lord, either that thou hast shed blood causeless, or that my Lord has avenged himself. But when the Lord shall have dealt well with my Lord, then remember thine handmaid. And David said to Abigail, blessed be the Lord God of Israel, which sent thee this day to meet me. And blessed be thy advice, and blessed be you, which has kept me this day from coming to shed blood and from avenging myself with mine own hand. For in very deed, as the Lord God of Israel lives, which has kept me back from hurting you, except you had hasted and come to me, surely there had not been left unto Nabal by the morning light any that pisseth against the wall. So David received of her hand that which she had brought him, and said unto her, go up in peace to thine house. See, I have hearkened to thy voice and have accepted thy person. And Abigail came to Nabal, and he And behold, he held a feast in his house, like the feast of a king. And Nabal's heart was merry within him, for he was very drunken. Wherefore she told him nothing, less or more, until the morning light. But it came to pass in the morning, when the wine was gone out of Nabal, and his wife had told him these things, that his heart died within him. Sounds like he had a heart attack. And he became as a stone. And it came to pass about 10 days after that the Lord smote Nabal, that he died. And when David heard that Nabal was dead, he said, "Blessed be the Lord that hath pleaded the cause of my reproach from the hand of Nabal, and hath kept his servant from evil. For the Lord hath returned the wickedness of Nabal upon his own head." And David sent and communed with Abigail to take her to him to wife. And when the servants of David were come to Abigail to Carmel, they spoke unto her, saying, "David sent us unto thee to take thee to him to wife." And she arose and bowed herself on her face to the earth and said, "Behold, let thy handmaid be a servant to wash the feet of the servants of my Lord." And Abigail hasted and arose and rode upon an ass with 5 damsels of hers that went after her. And she went after the messengers of David and became his wife. So we have two stories here. Two stories of two brides, two marriages, both of them married to a king. We have a story of a first wife named Michael, and she represents, in my eyes, or the way I'm preaching this message this morning, the first life, the first birth of Adam. Or also she could represent the connection to the law or religion instead of relationship. It all has to do with the first life versus the second life, which has to do with the marriage to Abigail. And so within these scenarios, we see that the second represents marriage to Jesus, grace, the new relationship through the new birth in Christ. And so these two stories tell of two different marriages in one king. And they have within them the elements of communion that speak of personal relationship with the presence of God. Most people that have studied the scriptures, they understand or believe that David is a type of Christ. Meaning in the Old Testament, he's a picture of Jesus that would come. The word Christ means anointed one. You got to just take my word for it, that throughout the Old Testament, God kept promising that one would come. And he was called Messiah by the Jewish people, which means anointed one. And the word Christ means anointed one in the New Testament. And so when he came, believers in Christianity believed that he was the one that the scriptures always promised would come. But there were various scriptures that maybe we could put up on the screen real quick as we go through, just to show you the point that I'm trying to make. Isaiah chapter 7 verse 14 says, "Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." In the chapter of Matthew, when it talks about the birth of Jesus, Matthew says Jesus' birth was the fulfillment of this passage of Scripture. He was born of a virgin. His name is, the terminology Emmanuel means God is with us. Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 and 2. "And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse." Jesse was David's father. See, all the children of Israel, see, Isaiah comes after the life of David. And so this is another prophecy that's telling us something about the future. There's going to be a stem or a branch that's going to grow forth out of Jesse. He's going to be a descendant of Jesse. He's going to be a descendant of David, because by this time David's also dead. And what's going to happen is that a branch shall grow out of his roots, and the Spirit of the Lord is going to rest upon him. The Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. Verses 3 and 4. "And shall make of him quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor." This is talking about the future, the millennial reign of Jesus. There's going to be a day when Jesus is going to literally rule and reign upon the earth. The Bible says he's going to judge not based upon like human beings judge, on what they perceive with their eyes or their ears, but instead he's going to judge based on righteousness, the righteousness of the Lord, the righteousness of the Word of God. Amen? And he goes on to say, and he's going to smite the earth with the rod of his mouth. That speaks of judgment. There's a lot of different scriptures. I'm not going to go through them all, but this is one scripture where David himself wrote. Right now I'm just trying to make the point to you that there's scriptures that show that David was a type of Jesus that would come. This is a passage of scripture that David himself wrote, Psalm chapter 22, verses 15 through 18. This is David writing a psalm, but it speaks of Jesus on the cross. My strength is dried up like a potsherd. That's talking about clay and the dryness of clay. My tongue cleaves to my jaws. Thou hast brought me into the dust of death. Dogs have compassed me. The assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. I may tell all my bones. They look and stare upon me. They part my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture. The same exact thing happened to Jesus as he hangs on the cross. His hands and his feet are pierced. There's soldiers down there on the bottom of the cross. They're throwing their version of dice to see who's going to win Jesus' garments. The very thing. So David, 1,000 years before Jesus ever dies, prophesies of what was going to happen. The point that I'm trying to make is that David is a type of Christ. And once again, these two women that were ended up being married to David represent the old life and the new life. I wanted you to see that much of the marriage to Michael is built upon the concept of flesh. Now, before I get to this particular verse of scripture, I want to explain to you what flesh means spiritually. Flesh spiritually describes mankind trying to do things in his own strength, trying to clean himself up from the outside, trying to go through the motions of religion, if you will. I go to church 3 times a week, therefore I'm better than I used to be. I read 4 chapters of the Bible a day. I used to not read the Bible, therefore I'm better than I used to be. I'm involved in ministry. I dress more appropriately in church than someone else that comes to church dresses. Therefore, I'm more holy. I'm more righteous. No, that's flesh. That's you with an outward attempt to clean yourself up on the outside. God said, when you anoint him, don't look at his outward appearance. Don't look at his stature. Man looks at the outside. I look at the inside. The scripture teaches in the Old Testament that God cut away flesh. I don't mean to be graphic with you, but I'm just here to tell you, I'm preaching the Bible. God said to Abraham before there ever was a nation called Israel, you will circumcise the foreskin of your flesh. Cut it off. Flesh in that instance represents something that was unclean, that was removed through the shedding of blood. Cut it off. Remove it from yourself. Ultimately, it was a type of the new life in Christ, and I'm going to show you that in a second, where a new life through the shedding of blood allowed a removal of sinful flesh to take place to allow people to have a relationship with God. David's first wife, first marriage, our first birth in Adam, our attempt through religion, all that first life stuff is connected to flesh. Turn to 2 Samuel chapter 3, verse 14. It's one of those passages of scripture like piss up against the wall, and it's like, okay, well, we know that the Bible's got to at least be PG-13. It says, and David sent messengers to Ishbosheth, Saul's son, saying, this is after he gets back to being king. This is after he's dealt with Nabal, he's got Abigail, his wife, he's coming back to the city, he's king again, and now it's time to clean up business. He said, he's basically saying, go fetch my wife, Michael. But he says right here, saying, deliver me my wife Michael, which I espouse to me for 100 foreskins of the Philistines. I don't know about you, but Lord, I prayed that the Lord would give me this gift where I'd be able to see the scriptures. And he started to do that. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'll read something and then the next thing you know, like, I can see it happen. This is probably one of those scriptures where maybe it wouldn't have been as... But what's happening here is this, is that after David took down Goliath, he was told that the king said, whoever was able, like this was the bounty for him to marry his wife, to marry his daughter, that you'd bring 100 foreskins of Philistines. Because, once again, it represents the removal of sin. These people were uncircumcised. They represent the world. They weren't in relationship with God. They were the enemy of God. David said, I just love killing Philistines. You don't even have to give me your daughter. I'll be happy to do it. And so essentially, he went and killed 100 Philistines. I don't know that he did it all by himself. He probably had men helping him. But they circumcised each one of them dead bodies, and they brought all that back, and that's how he purchased this woman to be his wife, which was 100 foreskins of Philistines. The point that I'm trying to make to you is this. This is another type, another representation of the fact that she represents the flesh. She represents that first life. She represents a connection to the first birth in Adam. What we need to remember is that circumcision, once again, was a sign of God's covenant with Israel, and what it represents spiritually is the removal of flesh through the shedding of blood. Romans chapter 2, verses 28 through 29. The Apostle Paul in the New Testament gives us some clarification. He basically gives us commentary on the Old Testament. And he explains to us what circumcision really represented. He says, "For he is not a Jew," which basically what he's trying to say is that the Jewish people were the people of God. Amen. In the Old Testament, they were the people of God. Now those that have put faith in Christ, whether you be Jew, whether you be from China, it doesn't matter. If you put your faith in Christ, you're the people of God. He says, "For he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision, which is outward in the flesh, but he is a Jew, which is one inwardly. And circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of God." In the first story, she lived with the king, Michael did. The king wanted to have a relationship with her, but she had no desire to really give him her heart. Instead, she looked down on him because she felt he was undignified in the way that he handled himself in front of all the people. Ultimately, the result of her desire for form and religion and her disdain for the new way that things were going to be done, the Bible says she was barren. If I remind you of that 2 Samuel 6, 13 and 14 passage, it says, "And it was so that when they that bare the ark of the Lord had gone 6 paces, he sacrificed oxen and fatlings, and David danced before the Lord with all his might, and David was girded with a linen ephod." This is a picture of grace. It's a picture of grace and sacrifice. It's a picture of God restoring his presence to sinful man. And it's a picture of somebody being full of joy.
Amen.
Because of it. Amen. And also, we have 2 Samuel 6, 16. "And as the ark of the Lord came into the city of David." I mean, here's the ark of the Lord coming back into the city of David. And a time for joyous occasion, a time for happiness, a time for joy. And here she stands in the window watching him. And instead of being joyous, she sees the way that he's performing. She sees the way that he's acting. She despises him in her heart. While he was excited about the presence of God and being in God's will, it appears that she was unhappy because of the appearance of things. And I'm kind of reading a little bit into it, but you can't tell me that that's not what was in her heart. It wasn't formal enough for her. It wasn't dignified enough for her.
Yeah.
To her, the display of it was beneath him. She didn't like the fact that he was humbling himself. Let me tell you something. Religion, this is a perfect example of religion. Religion wants things done a certain way. When the Lord begins to reveal to you the truth and he begins to show you what's really on the inside of your heart, you're going to start changing some things. And you might even start doing, but if you go down to church, the church down the road, guess what? They may be more concerned about the way you dress than the condition of your heart. As a matter of fact, there are churches that are going to be more concerned about the way you dress than the condition of your heart. And all I'm trying to say is this: don't walk up in here half naked. Lord help us. Amen. Don't walk up in here showing off parts of your body. We don't need all that. But at the same time, when you are introduced into a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Ghost moves into your heart, he will begin to deal with you on an individual level. He will begin to circumcise your heart. He will begin to do a work on the inside of you, and he will begin to reveal to you his will for your life. And he will begin to show you, when you dress like that, when you present yourself that way, that old boy right there might have a problem.
Amen.
Because of the way that you look and because of the way that you're revealing yourself. Do you want to hurt your brother? Do you want to hurt your sister? Amen? And so what I'm saying is this. The Holy Spirit, if we yield to him. Now, that just gives too much liberty, preacher. I need rules. I need rules and I need regulations. And I need to be told exactly how it's done. Well, you came to the wrong place. See, because whenever you submit yourself to the truth of the gospel, if you submit yourself to the truth of the gospel, it will hold you more accountable than the law ever could. Because long before you ever did the failure, the Holy Spirit was pleading with your heart. He was warning you ahead of time. He was telling you, don't go there, don't do that. But the reality of it is this: we all fall short of the glory of God. We don't always listen to the voice of God the way that we're supposed to. Therefore, we find ourselves in the midst of a mess. That's what she is, though. She went on in verse 20 and she said, "But that Michael, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet him and said, 'How glorious was the king in Israel today, who uncovered himself today in the eyes of the handmaids and of his servants, as one of the vain fellows shamelessly uncovers himself.'" And it went on to say that, "Therefore, Michael, the daughter of Saul, had no child until the day of her death." See, the law cannot produce fruit. The law, she was barren. She had no offspring. She had no child. That was a big thing to a woman in those days. She was barren. The law cannot produce fruit in the midst of your life. What do you mean by fruit? Well, go to Galatians 5, 22 and 23. Fruit of the Spirit. New Testament Christianity talk about your new relationship with God. We're not going to talk about the lust of the flesh because we don't have time to get there. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. Can you go back to verse 22? We don't have time to go through them all, but you know, the joy of the Lord is your strength. God wants you to have peace in the midst of your heart and in your life, peace in your relationship with the Lord. He wants you to be able to respond to people at times with gentleness. I'm not saying that there's never a time for firmness. I know that there's been times, sure enough, in my life, especially with my kids, that they needed some firmness in their life. But at the same time, there's a time to handle things with gentleness. I always loved that word, long-suffering, just because it always hits home with everybody in the congregation. It means patience in relationships. You know, patience is patience in circumstance. Long-suffering is patience in relationships. It means basically you just didn't cut somebody off because, you know what I'm saying, that you were just, "I'm just done with you. You got on my nerves one too many times. I'm done with you." Well, thank God Jesus didn't do that. Amen. Thank God Jesus didn't just cut us off. Amen? But that instead he was long-suffering towards us. See, these are fruit of the Spirit. If you live under religion, if you live under law, if you hold on to the old way of life, the first marriage, like Michael was, you'll never be able to produce the fruit of the Spirit in your life because it requires the moving of the Holy Spirit in you to produce that fruit in you. Abigail, on the other hand, she represents the second wife. You have to consider her situation a little more closely. For instance, her husband doesn't want to give way to the king. That's what religion does. It digs in its heels, and it doesn't really want to let people be free. People that live under religion aren't really free. And if we look back at, you don't even have to go back, but you'll remember that Nabal made the comment, every man wants to break away from his master. Nabal didn't want to remove himself from the old way of life, yet at the same time, Abigail presented herself to the king. She was a woman of good understanding, of beautiful countenance, but he was a man churlish and evil, obstinate and stubborn. His morality was contrary to the ways of God. And that's what many times, once again, whether it be our old way of life, holding on to the old way of life of sin, or the old way of religion of doing things, we're obstinate and stubborn, you know? Whenever you first hear the true message of grace, that it's that simple. What I'm trying to say is if you've been raised in church and you were in a church that practiced law and governed by rules, and somebody walks up to you and says, "Hey, true freedom is found through faith in Jesus and what he did for you at the cross." And they'll be like, Yeah, but I got to do this, and that. None of you understand what I'm saying. True freedom comes through faith in Jesus Christ and what he did for you. Now, you may not understand what all that means. And I can tell you that it's not a license to live any old way you want to. But that's the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. That through that faith, through the shedding of that blood, you now have relationship with God, and the presence of God is working in you and operating in your life. Now, if you'll go to Romans chapter 7, verses 1 through 4, there's a New Testament passage that speaks of what happened in this relationship of Abigail. The Apostle Paul is saying to the church of Rome, he says, "Know you not, brethren, for I speak to them that know the law, how that the law has dominion over a man as long as he lives." You know, whether you knew about the law or not, when you were first born the first time in Adam, God is going to judge everybody according to the law or according to Jesus. You're either going to be judged one of two ways. It doesn't matter whether you knew. You're not going to be able to plead ignorance on that day. God's law is going to judge people, or God's judgment was placed on Jesus. And so when you put your faith in Jesus, he took your judgment for you. But if you rejected that, then you're going to stand before God naked, just like you came into the world. And you're going to be judged by the law of God. And the law holds dominion over, like a master. Just as Nabal talked about the fact that Saul really was his master. The law holds dominion over a man as long as he lives. For the woman which has a husband is bound by the law to her husband as long as he lives. So Abigail was bound to Nabal. But if the husband be dead, she is loose from the law of her husband. So that if while her husband lives, she be married to another man, she shall be called an adulteress. But if her husband be dead, she is free from that law, so that she is no adulteress, though she be married to another man. Wherefore, my brethren, you also are become dead to the law by the body of Christ, that you should be married to another, even to him who is raised from the dead, that we should bring forth fruit unto God. So what we see here is an Old Testament passage that sounds a lot like this New Testament spiritual truth. Abigail was married to Nabal, represents the old life, the old law, the first marriage. Her husband dies. She's now free, and she goes to marry the king. In a similar fashion, you married Jesus through your death. In your faith with Jesus, the old relationship, the old marriage was severed. That relationship with the old life, whether it was the sinful life or a way of religion and rules and law, was severed. And now you've been married to Christ. Amen. And through that, you now have a new life and a new beginning. I had a lot more that I was going to say, but I can kind of tell that I've kind of gone over my time. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you three things to remember about Abigail. In your new walk with the Lord, in your new relationship with Jesus, first thing is comes out of 1 Samuel 25:18. And the title of that is Communion with the King. It says, then Abigail made haste, and she took 200 of loaves, 2 bottles of wine, and 5 sheep ready dressed, and 5 measures of parched corn, 100 clusters of raisins, and 200 cakes of figs. And she laid them on the asses. Basically, what she did was she came to humble herself, and she wanted to have communion, which means relationship with the king. I just put in here, don't let anyone stand between you and your relationship with Jesus. She disregarded her past life that was oppressing her and broke away from all that she knew before. Her desire above all else was to have communion with her king. She brought bread and wine to the king. These represent communion because they represent the body and the blood. They represent covenant. They represent relationship. So that's the first thing Abigail did. She separated herself from the past and she embraced the future. She wouldn't let anything from her past stand between her and the king. Second thing was humility. 1 Samuel 25:23-24. And when Abigail saw David, she hasted and she lighted off the ass, and fell before David on her face, bowed herself to the ground, and fell at his feet, and said, upon me, my Lord, upon me let this iniquity be. And let thy handmaid, I pray thee, speak in thine audience, and hear the words of thy handmaid. She lowers herself and takes the responsibility. You notice how she doesn't blame it all on Nabal? She doesn't blame it all on Nabal. She doesn't blame it on Nabal's men. She doesn't try to cast the blame on anyone else. Instead, she admits her connection to the past. She admits her connection to the failure. She was married to him. She was part of the failure. We used to be married to the law. We were part of Adam's fallen race. We can try to consider ourselves above others when comparing their failures to ours. But reality is that that isn't humility. And that will not result in freedom or liberty. Recognize your own sin and humble yourself before the king. So number one, she didn't let anything from the past stand between her and her communion with the king. Number two, she humbled herself. She took responsibility to quit blaming everybody else. You know? Okay, so you had a rough life. So did I. I've told you stories before. Daddy said things and he was real mean. He, you know, something, but he loved me. I know he did. I told y'all that before. He let me blow my snot on his shirt. I knew he loved me. What I'm trying to say is you can't, sometimes that story gets old. Can't blame it on that. You got to take responsibility for your own life. You got to take responsibility for your own failures. If you listen to the psychologist enough, he's going to fill your head and blame everybody else. And that, you know, no. We're talking about sin. Now. We're not talking about psychology. We all have our own part, and we have to take responsibility, and we have to humble ourselves. And if we'll do that, hallelujah, there's a marriage to a new king. Amen. There's a marriage to a new life. There's a marriage to a new relationship. Number three, work and grace. 1 Samuel 25:42. This kind of stuck out to me. It might not mean a whole lot to y'all, but it kind of stuck out to me. And Abigail hasted and arose and rode upon an ass with five damsels of hers that went after her. And she went after the messengers of David and became his wife. Five damsels and then the ass. An ass is a beast of burden, a donkey. It does work. Five is the number of grace in the Bible. And so what we're seeing is a mixture, at least this is what I see illustratively, of grace and work working together. Not work to earn grace, but for the Christian, now that he has grace, he learns to work for the Lord. And we'll close with Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. It says in Ephesians 2:10, we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has before ordained that we should walk in them. Amen. Part of Christianity, a big part of Christianity, is that after God has converted you, after he has begun to do a work in you, he begins to cleanse you on the inside. He begins to put his hope in you. Now he wants you to work. What are you saying? You want me to come cut the grass? That's not what I'm really talking about. See, for me, work isn't you cutting grass, although somebody got to cut the grass. Work is doing the work of the kingdom.
Yes.
Well, what do you mean? What I mean is you living for Jesus in the open. You living for Jesus the way the Lord leads you. I'm not telling you to do it the way that I would do it. I'm telling you to be led by the Lord, whether it be with your friends, whether it be with your family, whether it be in saying one little word, quoting a verse of scripture, whatever it is, you beginning to allow God to change you to the point where your old way of life goes behind you and your new life in Christ is in you and begins to come out.